How to be happy. This video is going to be a little different from my regular videos, just because I'm going to be talking about some stuff other than video games. Wait, isn't this supposed to be a guide specifically for gamers? It is, but I think that anyone watching this can learn from it and hopefully figure out what they can personally do to become a happier person. The fact of the matter is, depression and anxiety are pretty common for gamers to deal with, and I wanted to create a guide that will help gamers get through what they're trying to go through. The most traditional advice for people suffering from depression is counseling and medication. But while that works for some people, it's not for everyone. I just wanted to give people as many options as possible to maximize their happiness, because everybody deserves to be happy. Except Lucas Mainz. Before I get started though, I want to make absolutely clear that not everyone will be able to do everything on this list. Some of these things might require a job, reliable transportation, or the ability to move out, which might not be in your realm of possibility right now. What I really want you to do is look at the guide, figure out what is within your realm of control, and do whatever you can to bring up your overall baseline of happiness. Okay, so the first thing you need to do is realize that it's okay to be happy. Sounds kind of stupid, right? Well, this is a struggle for a lot of people. If you go to Alcoholics Anonymous or any 12-step program, they'll tell you that the first step is to realize that you have a problem. So how does that relate to what we're talking about right now? It means that you need to realize that you have to stop being your own worst critic for a second and let yourself be happy. There are some people with the mindset of, if I become happy, I'll remain stagnant because I'll be settling for something less than my potential. If I keep myself unhappy, it means I'll be able to figure out a way to fix my problem and grow. That isn't true. That's an example of your anxious state playing mind games to keep you down, because anxiety's whole job is to keep you on your feet, keep you running, always making sure nothing's out to get you. That may have worked 10,000 years ago, but the truth of the matter is, whether or not you stay stagnant or settle for less has nothing to do with your level of happiness. Actually, in the book The Happiness Advantage by Sean Aker, it describes how you'll be likely to accomplish more if you're happy than if you keep yourself stressed. Don't beat yourself up. You can be happy and still grow, I promise. So does that mean stress is bad? I think most people would agree that a little bit of stress is good and can even be motivational, but there always has to be a balance. The body requires a special kind of balance called homeostasis, which basically means you're not getting too much or too little of any one thing. So how do you know when you're dealing with too much stress? Well, let me give you an example. I had stress about coming up with a script for a new video, but only enough to motivate me to stop watching All Out and actually get my butt into gear. This is something called eustress, which is super beneficial to humankind. Once things start to inhibit you rather than help you though, it becomes distress. If there are any neuroscientists in the room, feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, but this is how I was taught how the brain works. So your brain has these two gates, the everything is okay gate and the everything is terrible gate. Your brain is consistently pushing information back and forth between the two gates to keep you safe and to keep you happy. People suffering from severe anxiety, however, have an everything is terrible gate which is slightly off its hinges, meaning that it'll put out more of the stress hormone cortisol than your everything is okay gate can handle. The goal is to come back to homeostasis so that both gates can work in tandem with each other again. The good news is that it is possible to mend that gate. You just need to give yourself permission to fix it. So the next thing you need to do is realize that all things psychological are also biological. Stress is caused by chemicals. Happiness is caused by chemicals.
Everything is chemicals!
That means in order to take care of your mind, you have to take care of your body. There are lots of things you can do in this regard, which means that you have lots of tools and options you can pick from to gradually make yourself happy. Now, before you say, "You're right, I'm a cow, I'm going to significantly alter my caloric diet and start exercising regularly from now on," I want you to make sure that you're still taking things step by step. While there are some people who experience life-changing events that motivate them to change their habits forever, for most people, it needs to be a gradual, step-by-step process. If you bite off more than you can chew, you'll choke and die. So focus on what the most important thing is first. Then once it becomes a habit, you can start doing more and more. Remember, good health isn't a destination, it's a journey. Don't feel like you need to do everything right now. When it comes to taking care of your body, I think the number one most important thing you can do is reduce your sugar consumption. Sugar is like fuel for cortisol, and most people with anxiety get way more sugar than they need. I used to love cereal, like I would eat 2 or 3 times a day kind of love it. And you know what? I was a depressed potato all of the time. Then I looked at how much sugar was in cereal, and that's when I realized just how much of it I was getting, and that was before I saw how much sugar was in the milk. I was getting more than an entire day's worth of sugar from one bowl of cereal, and I was eating like 4 a day. The rule that I was told was to keep your sugar intake below 60 grams a day. Now, for some people, that might be easier than for others, but make sure that you're doing what you can to gradually get below that threshold. Make sure you're eating more vegetables and getting plenty of protein. If you're drinking soda, stop. Like, seriously, stop. Find something to replace it, and make sure you're drinking plenty of water. Water is literally how your nutrients get through your body. The brain and heart are composed of 73% water, and the lungs are 83% water. I'm not going to go as far as to say, make sure you're drinking 8 large glasses of water per day, but you should definitely make sure you're getting as much as you need, especially if you suffer from dry mouth or headaches. Does that mean drop soda forever and never have more than 60 grams of sugar a day for the rest of your life? No, but be smart. Save it for special occasions. The only time you should ever break that rule is when you're with friends or family. Other than that, just don't do it. Exercise is also pretty important. I've seen multiple studies out there that show that exercise is more effective than medication in curing depression. Unfortunately though, exercise takes hard work, which means that it's super easy to lose motivation. Most people I know who work out do it for the result. They're looking to lose weight, have a nice six-pack, and build the thickest, most juicy calves that would make even Adonis himself jealous. This can't be your mindset. Realize that even if that's a goal for you, it can't be your primary motivation. Your motivation has to be keeping yourself happy and healthy, and this isn't going to change whether or not you ever look like Hercules. Alright, you've pulled me in, let's talk fitness. How you look is 80% diet and 20% exercise. If you want to lose weight, you need to burn more calories than you consume. Calories in, calories out. How you do this differs from person to person, so I would say that if you're looking to lose weight, cut out one thing from your diet at a time that you don't need, especially the things that have lots of sugar. Then, once you feel like you're ready, get rid of something else. Something I should note, however, is that you'll also want to start replacing some of the junk with healthy alternatives. Personally, I started replacing my morning cereal with a protein drink. For me, though, the problem isn't cutting the junk, it's adding the vegetables to my diet. Have you ever eaten a carrot? Do you know what those things taste like? Okay, that's cool and all, but what if I want to look like Broly from Dragon Ball? Now we're getting into the worst part about fitness. Cut and bulk cycles. Yay! The gist is that you want to lose fat and gain muscle. But guess what? When you lose fat, you also lose a little bit of muscle. And when you build muscle, you also get a little bit of fat. Guys with a six-pack have a body fat percentage of sub 15%, probably closer to 10% or less. The good news is, guess what burns fat? Muscle! This means that by doing weightlifting, you burn fat outside of the gym too. What has personally worked for me is to gradually cut out things I don't need in my diet, adding things that I do need, such as more fruits, vegetables, and proteins, and lifting weights until I'm ready to start adding more calories to my diet. If you're looking for the best results possible, I'd check out somewhere that discusses health and fitness more in depth. Heck, I think freaking Game FAQs has a place that talks about weightlifting. The main point I want you to remember though is that exercise isn't just something you do for a few months and then forget about. This is something that I want you to do for the rest of your life. So start small. In the book, The Lean Startup by Eric Ries, he talks about doing goals that are so small that you can't not do them. 5 push-ups a day. Do them as soon as you wake up in the morning so that if you forget, you have more chances to do them later in the day. A quick jog up and down the street. Just something. If you're motivated to do more, I want you to do more. But if you're struggling to get started, start small and work your way up. Remember, this is a journey, not a destination. Once it becomes part of your self-culture, you'll begin to love it. Another thing you need to do that high schoolers and college students are known to suck at is getting plenty of sleep. The amount of sleep you need is different for everyone, but if you're above 18, get a bare minimum 7 hours of sleep. If you're below 18, you should be getting at least 8 hours a night. What? I don't have time for that. I have homework and stuff. Guess what? Here you are watching a YouTube video. Obviously, you have some disposable time. This isn't something you can shirk off and say, yeah, I'll do the other stuff first and get more sleep on weekends. This is something you know will make you happier. Let's say you get 4 hours of sleep. How happy are you when you wake up? Now let's say you get 8 hours of sleep. How happy are you when you wake up? Oh, and by the way, you know how you're also exercising now? Here's the thing about muscles. When you work out, you're basically breaking your muscles so that they can fix themselves again to be even stronger. But they only fix themselves when you're resting. You want that six pack? Go to bed. Find more ways to get sleep. Trust me, you need it more than you realize. Now, this next part isn't as fun to talk about. Substance abuse. If you struggle with drugs or alcohol, you may not be able to get out of it alone. Get a support group. I'm not just saying that to give you the basic traditional advice either. I'm not just handing you off to someone. I really believe that they can help you with what you're struggling in. If you have substance abuse problems, I want you to trust me. You can overcome this. You don't have to make a massive change right away if you're not ready, but you will never be happy if you let addiction ruin your life. Unfortunately, I don't believe that I'm qualified to say anything more than that, but if this is something you're battling, promise me that you'll take that first step. It's always the hardest, but easily the best thing you can do for your life. Alright, now we can move on to some things that you can do that don't involve treating your body like a car. Although, let's be real, if your body were a car, it'd be a luxury vehicle, like a Buick or a Toyota Camry. Yeah, look at that thing. So another chemical that commonly gets overlooked is called oxytocin, the social chemical. If there are any neuroscientists in the room, feel free to correct me, but this is how it works to my understanding. Basically, it's the reason you're happy being with people and why you get lonely when you're isolated for extended periods of time. The deeper the connection you have with someone, the more oxytocin you release, which makes you even happier. Well, shoot, we're a bunch of gamers here. We have no friends. Well, guess what?
If you don't have one, get one!
One book that I've seen recommended a lot is How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie, but I can basically sum up what he says here. First of all, be approachable. Don't be a grumpy frowny downy. Smile a little. Listen to what people say and genuinely be interested. Ask them questions that give them the ability to tell you more about themselves. Remember the things they tell you. Never correct or criticize them. Be willing to admit your own mistakes. Uplift them. Appreciate them. Be positive around them. I remember back when I was in my first semester of college and the questions people asked were always the same. What's your name? Where are you from? What's your major? It was so annoying hearing the same things over and over again. But now that I look back on it, it really was a great way to start a conversation and create a connection. Remember, if friendship is a give and take, make sure that you're giving at least as much as you're taking. The more in-person one-on-ones you have, the better. What if there's no real way for you to meet people, though? This part is a little tricky. I'm going to suggest going out and doing things relevant to your interests, which for gamers might be conventions or tournaments. But if that's not possible for obvious reasons, you can still find communities online. This is also a double-edged sword, though. The internet brings with it anonymity, which allows people to be much more negative than they would be otherwise. Personally, I try to only post things on Twitter that I believe will make people besides Lucas Maines happy. But there are lots of people on Twitter that are different. Distancing yourself from social media has proven to increase happiness levels. So if I recommend you find people online, just know that I'm doing so with a grain of salt and would much prefer you meet real people wherever possible. So first of all, you need to find positivity. When I go onto Instagram, I'm usually looking at funny memes which brighten my mood. But it's also important to eliminate any of the negative or controversial content out there, especially the political stuff. No matter what, politics will not make you happy. Don't go near it. Avoid Reddit and Tumblr too. Even if you believe they help you in specific ways, the cons outweigh the pros for both websites. Other than that, it's hard to tell you where exactly to look for online communities because there are so many places for so many different interests. You could find a community for Smash Ultimate, writing, drawing, sports, all kinds of different things. You just need to look for where you want to meet people with common interests. Another option is Discord servers. But if you do that, I cannot emphasize enough, you need to leave if you see negativity. I would rather you be alone than in a negativity box. You can be happy alone, but you can't be happy when you're surrounded by unhappy people. And this leads me into another dark topic. We're about to go into the topic of abuse, so if that's not an issue you're dealing with, I'll leave a timestamp in the corner as well as in the description. Feel free to skip this so you can move on to the next step. But if you have friends who make you unhappy, you need to separate them from your life. I've personally had times when I've been in abusive relationships, and I have to tell you, it's hard to get out, especially when that person is providing a roof over your head. Let's start off small. If you have an abusive friend who you interact with outside of work, school, home, or basically any situation that doesn't require you to physically come into contact with them, Let them go. Immediately. Now. Remove them from your phone book or whatever you use to keep in touch with them. I would personally recommend trying to talk it out with them first, but if they don't listen and continue to make you regret speaking with them in the first place, then you know to pull the plug on that friendship. It's when the other person is someone you're forced to deal with where things get a little more tricky. If you have an abusive teacher, drop the class or ask your school guidance counselor to switch your classes. I've done this before, and they're usually pretty accommodating. If you're like 80% of the way into the school year though, their hands might be a little tied, in which case, I just want you to find a safe place during those class periods if you don't feel safe in the class. No grade is worth your long-term happiness. If it's a classmate, you might want to speak with the school administrator about it. But if they're dangerous, again, just switch classes where you can and find a safe place. I once had a classmate report someone who brought a gun to school just to walk out of the administration office and see him standing right in front of her. Yeah, you can imagine how excited she probably was in that situation. Your safety is what's most important. Be smart, but also be safe. Next is the tricky part. What if it's someone in your own family? What if it's someone you live with? Here's the truth. There's only so much you can do. If you're an adult, it's time to move out as soon as possible. Maybe move in with another relative or a close friend if you can. If you're a minor and you feel comfortable talking with a school counselor about it, I would recommend doing that. Maybe even calling Child Protective Services if you feel like you're in danger. If you don't think you can do that though, then I would just recommend avoiding conflict wherever possible until you can move out. Sadly, there are no right answers about what to do in this situation. You just have to be strong for the time being and realize that one day, it'll all be over. I promise. Alright, what next? I mean, at this point, you're eating right, you're exercising, you're making friends, and building meaningful relationships with people. What else? Next comes personal fulfillment. Some might see this as a hobby, and others might see it as another venture. If you're in high school, I would highly recommend joining one of your school sports teams. Not only will it give you a place to keep your body strong while creating new bonds with people like you, but it'll also act as a way for you to do something beyond yourself. This next part is all about self-improvement and contributing to society in some way. Let's take me for example. I read nonfiction books that I believe will help either myself or others, and I make videos that I hope either explain something or entertains people enough to provide significant value. I also play video games, both to see myself get better and to immerse myself in a fun fantasy world. Remember, lots of gamers spend all day playing video games and are still unhappy. It's important not only to take the previous steps I mentioned, but also find ways to see yourself grow in meaningful ways. Maybe you're a creative person, and by publishing stories you write or pictures you draw or music you produce, you can end up adding value to other people's lives. Maybe you're really into sports, in which case you can either join or help coach a team. Maybe you really like cars, and by learning and developing your knowledge of vehicles, you can be the guy everyone turns to when they have car problems. Just never get a truck. Once people need to move, there go your Saturdays. The most important part is that you're doing two things. You're growing, and you're enjoying the process. It's okay to have a large-scale vision of what you'd like to be one day, but only for reference. If you make it your motivation, then you'll just end up cheesed off and not wanting to do it anymore. You need to have fun along the way. Otherwise, you'll just never get to where you want to go. Find things that excite you. Find goals that excite you. I just want to make sure that you have something you can look forward to when you wake up in the morning. Now it's time for the most important part of the entire video. If you only take away one thing from watching this, I want you to remember this one specific thing. You are going to fail. Maybe you've heard of some people who all of a sudden say to themselves, I'm going to stop using drugs, exercise every day, and spend 6 hours every day learning how to program a computer. Those people exist, but those people are not you. Don't compare yourself to them. They have their own motivations for doing what they're doing, and you have yours. Maybe they just woke up from a hospital bed and found out that they need to make those changes in order to survive. Most people don't experience things like that. You can't worry about how successful someone else is. It's okay if you don't grow at the same rate as someone else. What matters is that you're moving in a positive direction. How many people do you know who say, I'm gonna start going to the gym, and then they end up stopping after 2 weeks? I don't care why they stop, that part isn't important. What's important is why they don't go back. They don't go back because they think, well, I didn't do it at all last week, guess I just won't do it anymore. That's stupid! You're not going to be perfect at it. There are going to be days and sometimes even weeks at a time when you might fail. That's okay! Just pick up where you left off. I can't emphasize this enough. If you just get back at it, eventually it'll become your comfort zone, and then you'll feel weird not doing it. You just have to keep trying. Even if you have to change goals, don't worry about the past, just keep moving forward. I would recommend everyone watching this video read The Power of Habit by Charles Duhigg. It'll help you get a better idea of what steps you can take to self-improve. There's also a quote I really like from Chinese philosopher Lao Tzu, which says, "Your thoughts become your words become your actions become your habits, and your habits become your character." Another philosopher named Will Durant said something similar. You are what you repeatedly do. Excellence is not an event. It is a habit. Remember, you can only learn step by step, and rather than taking every step at once, I just want you to take any steps you can, so long as they're in the right direction. So, what do you think? Did this video help at all? Did you find anything that'll work for you? Leave a comment to let me know, and I'll see you guys next time.